Simon & Schuster Audio presents Irena's Children, the extraordinary story of the woman who saved 2,500 children from the Warsaw Ghetto. By Tilar J. Mazzeo. Read by Amanda Carlin.
Preface. Krakow, 2009. When I first visited Poland, sometime around 2009, I thought it would be a vacation. My brother and sister-in-law, working with the U.S. State Department, had lived in Krakow for several years already, and had lived for a time in Wrocław before that, and had witnessed the country's integration into the European Union and its rapid second post-communist transformation. Their two small children, twins and then not yet toddlers, were learning their first words in Polish, and my sister-in-law was the director of an international school located outside the city. All three of us had grown up nominally Catholic, although none of us have ever had, I think, any particular interest in religion, because Krakow, unlike Warsaw, escaped being bombed or razed into oblivion at the end of the Second World War. Its Catholic heritage is everywhere in the old town architecture. It is a beautiful and, in some ways, still medieval city, but few areas of the city are as atmospheric as the historic Jewish quarter in Kazimierz, where tourists make pilgrimages to see Oskar Schindler's factory and to see the winding streets where parts of Schindler's List were filmed for Spielberg's motion picture. On the other hand, if you want to imagine what the Warsaw Ghetto looked like in the 1940s, there is no point in going to Warsaw. Only a small percentage of it remains there. The ghetto was razed in the spring of 1943. After the Warsaw Uprising, a little more than a year later, the rest of the city was leveled, and only 10% of the buildings were left standing. Warsaw is essentially modern. The year that I visited, the school was in the final stages of a major capital project, and the campus was being developed and surrounded by fencing. My sister-in-law spent her days, she joked, largely scolding local construction crews, and she had amassed a colorful arsenal of Polish profanity. The site had been rolling farmland for years, and at one edge of the property, a wood had been left to grow up in the midst of the fields, and later, scattered suburban houses. Standing together at the edge of the copse, I ventured to ask idly who owned the forest and why it had been clearly left wild for decades. After a moment's pause, she let out a sigh and said to me, "The trains to Auschwitz, you know, used to run not far from here. Not right here, but in the area." There was nothing in the woods, just parkland. And in the beginning she used to walk there, she said. But the 1st of November in Poland is All Saints' Eve, and everywhere in the country it is the tradition on that night to light candles on the graves of the dead. It was only on the first holiday at the school, when the roadside that skirted the edge of the woods was burning everywhere with candles, that she understood that something terrible had happened there. Later, locals told her that it was 1945, at the end of the war, when the Red Army was driving back the retreating Germans. The arrival of the Red Army brought no joy in Poland. Few women, from schoolgirl to most ancient babcia, escaped being raped by Soviet soldiers that winter in Krakow. And few Germans who encountered Soviet troops ever made their way back across the border. Across Poland, there were hundreds of nameless massacres like this one. Under communist rule, no one would have dared light a candle in the forest, but things had changed now. There were still old men, and especially old women, who remembered. "It's everywhere here," my sister-in-law said sadly. Poland is an unmarked graveyard, and what can you do except leave the past quietly buried? We went back to the school, and the bright voices of happy elementary school children came drifting into the corridor from all directions. I thought about the German deaths that happened here, and the tracks that led to Auschwitz, and the stories of infants torn from their mothers and smashed against brick walls to murder them. I thought about my small niece and nephew, and how I would kill anyone who did that to my children. My brother asked me a few days later if I wanted to see Auschwitz, and I said that I didn't. A few years later, my sister-in-law was one of the first people to tell me the story of the female Schindler, Irena Sendler, or in Polish, where women's last names take on a feminine case ending, Irena Sendlerova. Unconnected in space and time, those two conversations are, nevertheless, how this book started. I have never been able to separate the threads that connect Irena Sendler's story with that experience of the abandoned Polish earth and the voices of schoolchildren. As a writer, I stopped trying. In her native Poland, Irena Sendler is a heroine today, although that is also a relatively recent post-communist development. Her story, like so many stories across Poland, was quietly buried for decades. With her friends and a team of dedicated co-workers, Irena Sendler smuggled infants out of the Warsaw Ghetto, past German guards and Jewish police traders, in suitcases and wooden boxes. She brought out toddlers and school children through the city's foul and dangerous sewers. She worked with the Jewish teenagers, many of them girls of 14 or 15, who fought bravely and died in the ghetto uprising. And throughout it all, she was in love with a Jewish man, whom she and her friends spent the war anxiously hiding. She was a feather of a person with an iron spirit. A 4-foot-11-inch wisp of a young woman, in her late 20s when the war began, who fought with the ferocity and intelligence of an experienced general and organized across the city of Warsaw and across the divides of religion, dozens of average people into foot soldiers. Before she was arrested and tortured by the Gestapo, Irena Sendler saved the lives of more than 2,000 Jewish children. At immense risk, she kept a list of their names so that after the war their parents could find them. She could not know, of course, that more than 90% of their families would perish, most of them in the gas chambers at Treblinka. She also could not have guessed, as a left-wing radical and lifelong socialist, that after the war her children would be targeted under Soviet communism because of her wartime actions. But while Irena Sendler was undeniably a heroine, a woman of immense, almost unfathomable moral and physical courage, she was not a saint either. To make her a saint in the telling of her story is, in the end, to do a kind of dishonor to the true complexity and difficulty of her very human choices. Time after time, during my researches and interviews in Israel and especially Poland, those who survived that period in Warsaw said to me the same thing. I don't like to talk about those years with anyone who didn't live them, because unless you were there, you cannot understand why people made their decisions or the kinds of prices they paid for them. Irena's love life was anarchic and unruly, and she struggled with the self-knowledge that she was not a good wife or a good daughter. She placed her frail and ailing mother in grave danger and kept the knowledge of those risks from her. She was reckless and sometimes myopic. She ranked the abstract before the particular, and at moments she was perhaps even selfish in her selflessness. When the time came, she ultimately was a largely absent and distracted mother. She was at once a heroine, although she disdained that word too, and a flawed and average person. But she was also someone gifted with a sense of purpose and righteousness so powerful that she was able, by her example, to persuade others around her to be better than they otherwise might have been, and to do something together, amazingly decent and courageous. Throughout writing this book, I have been humbled by the courage of those others as well, the dozens of men and mostly women who quietly joined her. Irena said that for each child whose rescue she organized, on average, 10 people in Warsaw risked their own lives in the process. Without the courage and sacrifice of those who joined her, success would never have been possible. For those who aided Irena, the choices were monstrous. Punishment for helping a Jew began with having your family executed in front of you, starting with your children. It is trite and facile to describe to anyone who loves a child what it means to ache in the presence of life's fragility, and the vast majority of those who aided Irena had young children. Yet not once did any of these people, dozens of them, flinch from helping Irena in her mission. No one, Irena once said, ever refused to take in one of the Jewish children. This is the story of Irena Sendler, the children she saved, and those dozens of courageous others. It is also the complicated and sometimes dark but courageous story, too, of the Polish people. If there are too many names in the beginning of this book, consider that I tell the stories of some small fraction of those whom we know assisted Irena, and consider that, as the book goes on, the names become sadly fewer. I tell their stories here to do all of them some small honor. Their lives, and sometimes their deaths, speak to what we are capable of as average people in the face of evil and horror. Prologue. Warsaw, October 21st, 1943. Aleja Shuha. Irena Sendler knew her destination. The door slammed shut up front, and the black prison car lurched into motion. She had been given only 10 minutes to dress, and her fair bobbed hair was bed-tousled. Yanka Grabowska had run down the front path with her shoes and thrust them at her at the last moment, braving the violent caprices of the soldiers. Irena hadn't thought to lace them. She was focusing on just one thing, staying calm and keeping her face blank, placid. No sad faces. That was the wisdom Jewish mothers gave to their children when they left them for the last time in the care of strangers. Irena wasn't Jewish, but it was still true that sad faces were dangerous. They must not think I have any reason to be frightened. They must not think I am frightened. Irena repeated that thought silently. It would only make what was coming harder if they suspected what she was hiding. But Irena was frightened, very frightened. In the autumn of 1943, in Nazi-occupied Poland, there were no words more terrifying than Shuha Avenue. There may have been no words more terrifying anywhere in wartime Europe. It was the address of the Gestapo headquarters in Warsaw. The brutalism of its exterior seemed cruelly suited to the Germans' purpose. From inside the squat complex of buildings, the corridors echoed with the screams of those being questioned. Those who survived remembered afterward the rank scent of fear and urine. Twice a day, just before noon, and in the early evening, black vans punctually returned from the holding cells at Pawiak prison to collect the bruised and broken bodies. Irena guessed that it was just after 6 o'clock in the morning now, maybe 6:30 already. Soon the late October sun would be rising over Warsaw. But Irena had been awake for hours. So had everyone in the apartment building. Yanka, her trusted liaison and a dear friend, had joined a small family celebration for the feast of Saint Irena that night. After gorging on cold cuts and slices of cake, Irena's frail mother and her visiting aunt retreated to the bedroom. But Yanka had already missed the curfew and would have to spend the night. So the younger women camped out in the living room and sat up late, talking and drinking tea and cordials. After midnight, Irena and Yanka dozed at last, and by 3 a.m. the girls were sleeping soundly on makeshift cots. But in the back room, Irena's mother, Janina, was restless. How Janina had enjoyed hearing the carefree murmur of the girls' voices. She knew from her daughter's taut jawline that Irena was taking chances, and she had a mother's heavy worry. Pain made it hard to sleep, and so Janina let the thoughts carry her. Then, in the darkness, came a sound that she knew was wrong. The heavy thudding of boots.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, Use the link in the video description.